Today we're going to be making an irregular silicone block mold using the Moldmax 30, and then we're going to cast a lightweight casting resin called the Featherlite. Now, elements like this, there's a great benefit of having them cast in a lightweight product like the Featherlite, and still retaining a lot of the detail. Now, this project calls for several of these shields to be casted or made, and for that reason, we're going to be making a mold. And furthermore, I'm going to show you how to make a irregular block mold that follows the contours off our shield. That way, we're going to save some material, which results in saving money. Now, to start, we're going to CNC a tooling board to make our original model. And then we're going to take that model and we're going to use some hot melt glue to adhere it to the working surface, in this case, a melamine board. Once you adhere that down to the board, I'm going to press down on it. And then we're going to go ahead and dispense some of the Epsilon resin. This is with the 101 fast hardener. This is a product that's dispensed by weight. So we're going to make sure we use an accurate gram scale. And we're going to go ahead and dispense the part A. Now the Epsilon with the 101 fast hardener has a mix ratio of 100 parts of the A to 20 parts of the B. And then we can go ahead and mix the two components together. As always, make sure that you're scraping the sides and scraping the bottom off your mixing container. It's really important that you mix these components very thoroughly so that we don't have any unmixed product end up on our model. So once the material is thoroughly mixed, we can transfer it into a larger container. And basically what we're doing here is we're reducing the mass size. We're going from a small container was concentrated and over an inch thick to a larger container. So the material is not going to start to heat up very fast, and therefore it's going to give us a little bit more work time. Now we can go ahead and start applying the material to our model. And now I'm going to take a regular chip brush and I'm going to apply a very thin layer of the Epsilon to the edge of this shield. Now remember that we do want parts of the castings that are coming out of this mold to be glossy, while other parts are supposed to be matte. And that's why we're putting the Epsilon on parts of our model here. Everything that is coated with Epsilon is going to come shiny out of that mold. So what that basically means is that any kind of detail that you apply to your model is going to transfer into your mold and eventually into your castings. Now, once this is all coated, we're going to allow it a partial cure for about 1 hour, and then once that has partially cured, we can go ahead and apply the next layer. For the second layer, we're going to proceed by dispensing the material same way we did previously, but we're going to add some So Strong Black. The reason why we're adding the pigment to this is really so we can actually see where we're applying the product. And as you can see here clearly, you can tell where we apply the second layer and we don't have to keep going over it, wondering if that's already covered. Now, one visual check, and then we're going to allow this a full cure for 16 hours before proceeding on to the mold making portion. For the mold making portion, this is going to be a irregular block mold. And what that means, it's not just a square block, but there are some edges, some shapes that we need to maneuver around in order to create a tighter mold. We're going to end up using less of the silicone for a mold like this than if we made a square mold. You should have at least about 3/4 of an inch to 1 inch of space beyond your model. If it's too thin, this could be very flimsy and can potentially distort the castings that you're going to be casting into this mold. Anything above an inch becomes unnecessary and a waste of material. Now, for the mold box itself, I already decided I need something flexible. And for this application, I'm going to be using this aluminum flashing. You can buy this in various sizes and thicknesses at your hardware store. These ones are already pre-cut to a specific height. And my next step here would be to adhere using some hot melt glue, some buttresses. They're going to further strengthen that shape that we're putting up. Aluminum flashing on its own is very thin, and you're not going to have a good time trying to glue it down and have it stay in place. So these buttresses are going to help us shape that mold box, so to say. And we're going to put some hot melt glue down on the working surface, and then on the buttresses, on the wood itself, and then we're going to press that and hold it in place until the hot melt glue firms up. And you can see that it's really easy to get a very specific shape. You can bend this material very easily, 90 degrees, no problem. It's going to keep a nice clean line around your model. So it's a very practical thing to have in your mold room whenever you're doing any kind of irregular shape molds. Now, just one quick look over the entire project. Make sure everything is ready to go, and we can go ahead and start mixing our material. For this project, we're going to be using the MoldMax 30, and because we're under a tight deadline, we're also going to be using the cure accelerator called FastCat 30. Now, the MoldMax 30 can be either used with the FastCat Part B alone, so instead of using the Part B off the MoldMax, you replace it with the FastCat, or you can mix the two Part Bs together. And I'm going to look at the technical bulletin here and use that as a reference. And we're going to mix the five parts of the MoldMax 30 Part B and five parts of the FastCat 30 to get about a 20-minute of work time and a two-hour demold on this product. But before we proceed to making the mold, you have to understand that the addition of the FastCat will reduce the shelf life and the production life of a mold. It's great when you need to turn around and make a mold real fast and needs to cure fast, but you have to understand that there is limitations for using the product. Now, because of the mix ratio that we decided to use, which is 100 of part A, 5 parts part B, and 5 parts of the FastCat, the pot life or work time has gone down from 45 minutes to 20 minutes, and the cure time from 24 hours to about 2 hours. Now, we're going to go ahead and combine the components together. Now, since we have to mix a large quantity of the material, it's really beneficial to have a turbine mixer with an electric drill here. We already know that we're going to be vacuum degassing the product, but we do need to work fast. We do have a accelerant in the rubber, so it's going to shorten our pot life and our work time. And therefore, using a turbine mixer like this is very beneficial. Now, I'm still going to make sure that I scrape those sides with a mixing stick. That way, there's no unmixed components left whatsoever in our mixing container. And once we mix this thoroughly, we can go ahead and vacuum degas the product. If you haven't seen how vacuum degassing works, you can click on the link above. It's going to take you to a video showing you exactly what vacuum degassing is and how it's done. Here you can see a rise and a fall of the material, after which we continue to vacuum the product for about another 60 to 90 seconds, and then we can remove it and can start pouring into the mold box. Now, as always, when you do pour-on applications with these products, you always want to pour pretty much in one area and let the material seek its own way. What that does, it basically pushes any kind of air away from the model and guarantees that there won't be any air bubbles stuck to your actual model or in the mold, so that you're going to be transferring those into your casting. So it's really important, pour in one area and then let the material seek its own way up. The material is now allowed a full 2 hours to cure before demolding. Now, to remove the aluminum shim, it's really easy to just take some isopropyl denatured alcohol and put it on the hot melt glue. That's going to soften the glue, and the removal of these buttresses and the aluminum shim is going to be a lot easier. Now we're going to peel the mold away. And as you can see here, the molding silicone captured all the detail from the original model. And we have that nice glossy outer layer that's going to look more like metal versus the surface that has that rough wood kind of texture to it. By making an irregular block mold, we ended up saving about 4 pounds of silicone, which results in about $40 of material savings. So making a smarter mold will always end up saving you money. To mimic some of the metal gloss in an original object, we're going to put some cast magic down and we're going to brush that around. This is called pig iron cast magic, and it's one of my favorite. Looks really good on castings, and we're going to brush that around, and you can see that the silicone kind of grips on and holds that powder in place. Now, since we're planning to paint the casting after the resin has cured, I'm going to go ahead and sprinkle some talc powder onto the rest of the mold. And what the talc powder does, it grips onto our casting resin and allows the paint to stick much better to the resin than if we did not use any of the talc. So always think with the end result in mind and what's going to give you the best results for what you're doing. Any of the excess powder should be either shaken out or blown out using our air hose. Here I'm just going to turn this around and shake some of this out. And then we can go ahead and proceed to pre-mixing the Featherlite. Now, what is Featherlite? It's a lightweight urethane casting resin that's already filled so that it will be nice and lightweight. It can actually float. And when you open the container first, you're going to see this hardened product. It's going to be hardened material. This needs to be broken up and mixed in thoroughly. The material has separated from the resin and needs to be mixed in thoroughly before proceeding. You want to really mix this until all the lumps in these products have disappeared. You can press them against the side of the mixing container, scrape them until they literally liquefy and you cannot see them in the different components, the part A and the part B. Now, this is a one-to-one mix ratio by volume, so we don't need to use a gram scale for this. We can simply start by marking our cups and pouring the material into those. And I'm going to use some UVO black here to add some color to our part B. Just by you adding a drop or two, you're going to give it a nice soft warm a gray color versus a yellowish white. It also looks much better and easier to paint when you have a gray background versus a white or yellowish background. Now we can go ahead and combine those two parts in a mixing container. And as always, make sure that you scrape the sides, scrape the bottom of your mixing container. You should see one continuous color. There should be no streaking. And once you have that mixed, just like we did the silicone previously, we're going to pour in one corner of the mold, and then we're going to let the material seek its own way up. And it's going to fill all those crevices, and it's going to push the air bubbles away from the mold and fill the casting. Now, this has allowed a full cure for at least 2 hours before removing from the mold. Now that the product is cured, I'm just going to go around the perimeter and break some of that tension between the casting and the mold. And then we can simply peel that mold away to reveal a fully detailed casting. And you can tell here that wherever we coated the shield with the Epsilon, it left a nice and smooth and shiny texture, so to say, in the mold and fully detailed casting, while the center of the shield that we did not coat was left with that rough wood texture that we wanted to keep. Now, to finish our project, I'm going to go ahead and paint this using some acrylic paints. So these are basic acrylics. And as you notice, I'm not using any primer on this piece. Because we used the talc earlier in the mold, it left the surface of this casting with some tooth so that the acrylic paint would stick a lot better to the casting itself. Since we have a mold, I was able to make two of these lightweight shields. And since they're painted, these are now ready to be hung in our themed lobby.
Now, because our castings are super lightweight, we're able to install them very easily onto the wall with some Velcro. And the other one we installed right up there, where because it's nice and lightweight, it causes no issues.
Now, if you got inspired by our project and you would like to do some of your own casting and mold making, you can get any of one of our products by visiting one of our distributors around the world.
If you like this video, hit the thumbs up button. And to keep up with our latest mold making and casting videos, remember to subscribe.